Good evening and welcome to St. Francis Parish. We're happy you're all here tonight. It's a lovely crowd, so thank you very much for all coming.
He was born in Rochester, New York, and he holds various positions of responsibility in his community, both in administration and information of young Brazilians. He holds advanced degrees in theology and sacred scripture from Regis in Toronto, from the Pontifical Biblical Institute in Rome, and from the École Biblique in Jerusalem. Tom has lectured in sacred scripture in Canadian universities, Toronto, Windsor, and in London. He has served as executive director of the Newman Center Chaplaincy at the University of Toronto. In 1999, he was appointed by the Canadian Conference of Bishops to be the Chief Executive Officer and National Director of World Youth Day, where the papal visit of John Paul II took place in Toronto in July of 2002. I also worked with Tom as the Director of Liturgy at that time. I often say that's why I have no hair, and my beard is white. Not because I was working with Tom. In July 2003, Father Rosica became the founding Chief Executive Officer of Salt and Light Television. Tom was appointed by the Vatican as an English-speaking media attaché for several of the most recent synods. In 2009, Pope Benedict appointed Father Rosica as a consultant to the Pontifical Council for Social Communications. Following the resignation of Pope Benedict, the Vatican asked Tom to join the Holy See Press Office and to serve as one of the official spokespersons for the transition in the papacy. At the end of the papal transition in April 2013, the Vatican asked him to serve as English language assistant to the Holy See Press Office. From December 2011 until June 2015, he served as president and vice chancellor of Assumption University in Windsor. Father Rosica is a member of various boards and universities and institutions throughout the world. He is the author of several hundred articles and columns in numerous languages in various publications, as well as several books. And he has received so many honorary doctorates and awards that it would be too numerous to mention. It is with great pleasure and without further ado that I introduce to you my friend and colleague, Father Tom Rosica.
We've been very good friends for a long time. I think I'm in Francis friendly territory tonight. Not only because the parish is named after St. Francis of Assisi, but I know the tremendous work that Father Joe has done here. You're very blessed to have him, and he's blessed to have you. Bishop Crosby spent the day with us in our studio today. We formally dedicated our new broadcast center in Toronto, which we moved into 3 weeks ago. So the bishop came from Hamilton, the general secretary came from the CCCB, and we just had a very beautiful afternoon, and the bishop was very happy to know that I'm entering his territory, especially to speak about Laudato Si. I want to start off by speaking about three great themes of Pope Francis's pontificate. I've had the privilege of accompanying him, being with him, from the first day, literally. And not only the first day, but 3 days before that, when we went out for our famous walk in Piazza Navona before the conclave, which he doesn't like to remember, doesn't like to stop remembering or reminding me of what I said. I said foolish things to him, teasing him that night, and he reminds me of that. Three documents that have come out of this pontificate so far, and I'm sure that you're familiar with them. This might be a little too loud. Okay. The first important apostolic exhortation that came out from Pope Francis, Evangelii Gaudium, the joy of the gospel, came out shortly after he was installed, so that he was Pope, and it was supposed to be a summary document of the synod on the new evangelization, which had taken place some months before under Pope Benedict, the synod that I attended. Evangelii Gaudium, the joy of the gospel. And let me try to summarize that document by saying it was the document about the air we breathe as Catholic Christians. We're caught up in this culture, in this environment, and what a beautiful way to say it's the joy of the gospel. The air we breathe, the wind under our wings. The second document that came out from Pope Francis, there was another encyclical called Lumen Vitae, Lumen Fidei, the Light of Faith, but it was kind of a two-handed or four-handed encyclical because much of it was prepared by Pope Benedict, and because it was underway, it was kind of completing the trilogy of Faith, Hope, and Charity of Benedict. It appeared under Francis's pontificate, his Petrine ministry, and let's put it this way, Francis signed off on it, but it's very much Benedict. It's a beautiful document. But the real encyclical, the first big encyclical under Francis, was this document that we're going to speak about tonight, Laudato Si. Laudato Si. How do I summarize that? It's the house that God prepared for us. It's the house, the earth that we inhabit. And just picture it like this big superstructure, this house, this beautiful dwelling that God has given us. So the first thing, the air we breathe, the environment, the culture, Evangelii Gaudium, the house that God has given to us, the earth, the planets, the whole constellation of everything. And the third document that came out last April, very much spoken about, very much misunderstood, but an absolutely beautiful document, Amoris Laetitia, the joy of love. And for me, I summarize that document as the way that we live inside this house. Our behavior, our relationships, how we relate to one another, what kind of love do we express to one another. So keep in mind those three themes, the culture and the air we breathe, which is the joy of the gospel. The second one is the house that God has given us, this whole inhabited earth, the oikoumene. The word ecumenism comes from the Greek word oikoumene, which literally means the whole inhabited earth. And the third is our relationships, how we live within this house. When we approach those three documents in this way, it makes beautiful sense what Pope Francis is doing for us. He's providing us with a culture, with a language, giving us new air to breathe, helping us to appreciate the house that we live in, and also offering us some guidelines, some hopes, a plan of how to live in this house. Tonight, I want to speak about Laudato Si. It is a magnificent document. It's a long document. It's not an easy document. And I have to say, having been involved with church documents and communication and encyclicals and exhortations, what amazed me about Laudato Si is how much nonsense was written about it in the months before it came out. I never read such folly of people who were absolutely certain that they knew what the Pope was going to talk about. And no one had seen it. Very few of us had seen drafts of the document. And I saw what I considered some intelligent people writing these terrible things. What right does the Pope have? It's going to be a whole document on climate change. It's going to condemn capitalism. It's going to do this. And the reams of stuff that came out was astounding, truly astounding, which made me realize that people are nervous about this. Something's cooking here. How many times has this happened with previous encyclicals? Encyclicals are dropped, they come and they go and they go on the shelf. But this one was a long-expected document. And when it came, it was a massive rollout. I was involved in part of the rollout when you present the document. They had a massive press conference at the Vatican in June, two years ago, in the Synod Hall, filled with about 400 people, and another satellite room with people watching, a big panel discussion presenting this. Normally, that's not how documents are presented. And I was asked to go to Washington, where there was a massive press conference in the National Press Center in Washington, D.C. It was amazing, all kinds of interest, cardinals and bishops and secular journalists, and it was really a great, great rollout. But the question remained, what was this about, and why was there so much interest generated, so much misunderstanding, so much critique, and I must admit that a lot of the people who did a lot of critiquing got egg all over their faces when they realized that this is not just a document that it mentions climate change. This is not a document that tells people to turn off lights and air conditioners and everything else. Those things are mentioned. This is a profound document of conversion. It's about conversion. And the other unique thing, if you look at the encyclical itself and the different formats, the document is addressed, and it's very important how it's addressed. It's addressed to all the people of humanity. It's not addressed to bishops and cardinals or religious or lay people or Catholics. It's addressed to the whole world. In other words, the Pope is addressing a major issue that's of importance and of interest to the entire world. There's a story within the story of Laudato Si. And I'm presuming that many of you have read different parts of it or have you heard about it, and some of you may have read it all. This is Francis's landmark encyclical, and the subtitle is On the Care of Our Common Home. Laudato Si, as you know, is part of Francis's Canticle of the Creatures. Francis of Assisi was one of my... Who doesn't like Francis? Francis is loved. He's the most universal saint, loved by not only Catholics and Christians, but by people of all denominations and walks of life and religions and whatever. This document is an overview of the environmental crisis from a very religious point of view. Because until now, the dialogue about environment has been framed mainly using political, scientific, and economic language. And we've also, perhaps not so publicly, but maybe under our breath, have dismissed these ecology lovers, oh, those tree huggers, oh, those hippies, those development and peace people, all those strange birds. They're into recycling. You know how we do it. Maybe we don't do it like that, but you know, deep down inside, oh, we like Laudato Si, oh, you're a hippie. You know? You must have a ponytail. Or Laudato Si, you eat granola? You know, I tell you, this is about much more than granola and ponytails and hippies and all kinds of other stuff. Until now, the dialogue was framed mainly using political, scientific, and economic language. But now, suddenly with this document, the language of faith enters the discussion clearly, decisively, systematically. The encyclical was released in June 2015. It teaches that the way we interact with the natural world is deeply related to how we interact with our fellow human beings. There's a link here. Relating to creation is also about relating to one another. In fact, one of the things I've told people who are all nervous about this and what it's about and what's it really doing and the Pope is undermining things is that the Pope is building on a long, rich tradition that his predecessors had spoken about. And let me tell you this, may surprise you. You know who the Green Pope was of recent history? Not Francis, it was Benedict XVI. Benedict did tons of things. Now, part of it is that he's German, and the Germans are big into ecology. If there's some German people here, you know what I mean. I lived in Germany, and long before we were doing recycling here with blue boxes, you had green, red, yellow, every kind of box that was in the apartment in Germany and in the rectory where I lived when I was studying. Benedict installed the solar panels for the audience hall just after he became Pope. Benedict was very attuned to this. Now Francis has come along and he's getting all the credit for this. But Francis is building on a long tradition of Pope Benedict, of Pope John Paul II, and even if you go back a little further, the popes started teaching about the social concerns, the social order, Leo XIII, Rerum Novarum. They may not have mentioned ecology per se, but the ground was being prepared for all of this. There's no valid way to separate these two aspects of care for human beings and care for the earth. Therefore, all decisions about the natural environment are ethical decisions, and this also implicates business. It implicates the economy, how we relate to one another, because who are the first people who reap the mess, who are the victims of our lack of care for the earth? It's the poor. It's the third world. I remember a year ago, just around now, landing in the Philippines. I'd never been to the Philippines, and I had to go for the Eucharistic Congress in the Philippines because I was one of the speakers. And I was warned to be careful of the pollution. And when the plane landed, we didn't go to Manila, I went to Cebu, another island. And for those days that I was there, it was a staggering effect, the pollution that was there. It's because it's summer at that time of year down there, it was very hot, but the pollution, and it was difficult to breathe. And you begin to say to yourself, Who are the first recipients of our lack of care and concern for the environment? It's the poor and it's the third world. The encyclical Laudato Si is addressed to everyone living on the planet. It's a pretty wide audience that Pope Francis is addressing. As I mentioned, the address says everything, if you look at those first letters of any encyclical. It calls for a whole new way of looking at things. We face an urgent crisis when the earth, the Pope says, has begun to look more like an immense pile of filth. For those of you who follow Francis's teaching, he's extremely graphic and visual and vivid with his images. That's one of the things I love about him. There's no soft talking about language. Filth, disgusting. And then when it sounds in Spanish, it's even better, and in Italian. Still, the document is hopeful. It reminds us that because God is with us, all of us can strive to change the course. Someone asked me once on one of the television interviews, so sum it up in just a few words, what's Laudato Si about? I said, well, you know, if you watch a Notre Dame football game and you see the end zone and you see this big sign, God so loved the world that he gave his only son, John 1:14. It's a beautiful line. Maybe it appeared on your Christmas cards. I said, what Laudato Si tells us is, let's take a moment and think about the world that God so loved, the home that God prepared for his son, our home, our common home. We can move towards an ecological conversion that's at the heart of this encyclical, in which we can listen to the cry of the earth and the cry of the poor. They go hand in hand, the cry of the earth and the cry of the poor. And this is a deeply upsetting, uncomfortable encyclical because it's not content simply to face up to the institutional and moral issues of climate change and environmental degradation, but addresses the deeper tragedy of humanity itself. Certain political leaders who won recent elections in other countries, I won't mention, took great strides and great pain to denounce and deny the whole topic of climate change. They said there's no issue about climate change, there's nothing to worry about. In fact, one of my great discoveries during the election recently in the United States, and even in preparation for the papal visit to the United States, was to discover a United States senator, not a Catholic, a Jew, claims to be an agnostic. He gave two or three filibuster addresses on the Senate floor of the United States Senate about Laudato Si, and he also quoted Evangelii Gaudium. And I had the great pleasure of interviewing Bernie Sanders for our network on the eve of the papal visit last year to the United States. And I remember asking him, I said, Senator Sanders, what is it about Laudato Si? He says, it's our agenda. This is our issue. This is not made up. This is not made up by Chinese scientists or somebody else, as another leader may have said or said. This is a real big issue. And it took Senator Sanders to bring this to the knowledge of the whole Senate of the United States. Whether they did something about it or will do something is yet to be seen. The path traced out in the encyclical is detailed and rich. Here are some of its key messages. All human beings are affected, and everything in nature too, by climate change, the misuse of natural resources, waste and pollution. Everything is interconnected. That's one of the great gifts of the encyclical. Nothing is disparate. Everything. Human relations, our relations to the earth, the way we care for things, it's all part of the bigger picture. There's an interconnection. We cannot understand the social or natural world or any parts of it in isolation. And this has been one of our big problems all these years. We compartmentalize things. We put everything in a little category and we don't see the link between them. Everyone must act responsibly to save our world, from individuals who do recycling, to enterprises reducing their ecological footprints, to world leaders setting and enforcing ambitious carbon reduction targets. We must be truthful and not hide or distort facts in order to gain selfish advantage. And one of the other beautiful things that comes about from Laudato Si is the necessity of dialogue. I brought with us tonight our latest magazines of Salt and Light that just came out before Christmas. And we chose as the theme of that dialogue. Because if there's a real signature piece of Pope Francis these past 3.5 years, it's the necessity of dialogue. And I'll ask those of you, I'll leave magazines here, and I've got boxes for other parishes. If that I ask you to take to your parishes and spread that. You'll see the wide-angle view, the 360 view of how Francis sees dialogue as essential to our existence on this earth. We have to engage in dialogue. Beyond the industrial age's short-sighted confidence in technology and commerce, we transcend ourselves in prayer, in simplicity, in solidarity, and in dialogue with others. Laudato Si is also a very important instrument of evangelization of our contemporary world because it strives to answer the deeper questions about ecology and the environment within God's revelation as found in creation and the strong teachings and consistent teachings of the Catholic Church. This is not some invention of a Jesuit pontiff. That's what a lot of people dismiss. Oh, he's Jesuit. Thank God. Okay? Thank God he's the Bishop of Rome at this point. But what he does is draw from academic, education, science, philosophy, spirituality, and the deep theological tradition of the Church. And at this critical moment in history, what is at stake is not just for our own biodiversity, but our very survival. Our survival is at stake with this document. Scientists calculate that those most harmed by global warming in the future will be the most vulnerable and marginalized. The dignity and rights of human beings are intimately and integrally related to the beauty and the rights of the earth itself. After all, who will dare to speak for the voiceless resources of our planet? Who will step up to protect the silent diversity of species? Will our generation accept the responsibility for pushing our environment over the tipping point? Christian spirituality, our spirituality, has a precious contribution to make in responding to the environmental crisis, because it can motivate us to a more passionate concern for the protection of our world, this world that God gave us. For Francis, spirituality does not mean turning away from the world, running off to the hills, going off to Qumran because we don't want to be caught in the thick of things in the big cities. There's a mystical meaning to be found in everything in this universe. And some of the poetic lines and poetic language is used, and it is really inspiring. In terms of the formulation of the encyclical, there was a massive, wide consultation with this encyclical, and I can assure you, having seen it, having been part of it, having observed how far it went, they drew from the knowledge and experience of people, Christian and non-Christian, religious traditions, political, scientific. It really was a masterful effort on the part of the Holy Father to draw in the best information you can get. A good spirituality finds God not only in the interior of our hearts, in the quiet, nice, peaceful moments, but also in creatures outside of ourselves. And as the Pope says in one line in paragraph 233, in a leaf, in a mountain trail, in a dewdrop, in the face of a poor person, we see God's creation at work. At the heart of Laudato Si is a fundamental question, a shocking and jarring question. What kind of world do we want to leave to those who come after us, to our children who are now growing up? Francis continues, the question does not have to do with the environment alone and in isolation. The issue cannot be approached piecemeal. This leads us to ask ourselves about the meaning and existence of life. What's at the basis of our life? What's the purpose of our life in this world? Why are we here? What is the goal of our work and all of our efforts? What need does the earth have of us? It's an interesting question. I never expected to see that question. What need does the earth have of us? It's not simply a sampling of issues that the Pope decided to send out a questionnaire and get feedback that he considers important for understanding. But he said we must understand all of these questions amidst the noise and distraction of the information overload. Access to clean drinking water, for example. The crisis of hope in a better tomorrow. The myth of progress. Modern architecture and what it means. The culture of relativism. Drug abuse in rich countries. The need to accept one's own body and its femininity or masculinity. How it's not healthy to cancel out sexual difference. All of these themes are part of this encyclical. The diversity of species, rising sea levels, global inequality. It's an incredible list, the contents. Francis's tone is passionate, it's personal, it's urgent. He's drafted the major encyclical with the mind and heart of a disciple of Jesus and the pen and voice of a prophet who has seen and personally experienced the grave injustices and ugliness that human beings can cause on this earth. And never forget where Francis is coming from. This is absolutely essential to understand everything he's doing. He's coming from the third world. He's coming from a country that knew a dirty war that lasted a long time. Inequality, unequal distribution of wealth and resources, poverty, death, all kinds of things had formed this Jesuit. So just by way of summary of the key points, the encyclical addresses a moral issue. The encyclical is a call to care for others. The encyclical is a call to care for God's creation. Laudato Si speaks of Catholic distinctiveness. The Catholic community brings several important gifts to the table in discussing creation and the environment. And Laudato Si invites us to one of the most important contributions of this document. It's my favorite section. It invites us to an integral ecology. We are called to live an integrated life rooted in what Francis calls integral ecology. We're called to cooperate with God's design in our relationship with the natural world and with one another. When we get these intertwined relationships right, what happens? We end up growing closer to God. We end up appreciating and reverencing more this beautiful created order that God gave us. We understand that our individual decisions also have social consequences. And perhaps more than anything, we realize that we are our brothers and sisters' keepers. We recognize the strong link between recognizing human dignity and the care for the natural world. We know that population is not the problem. It's rather what Francis calls the throwaway culture that's the problem. And he uses that word very, very often, throwaway. The styrofoam culture, throwaway. When we apply that principle to people, we know what happens. Laudato Si invites Catholics to participate in public life and to work for the common good. And there's a sense of urgency, which I really appreciate. This is the time to act. We must act now. Francis touches people's hearts and he moves them to action. It's a time to work together. It's a teaching moment and not simply policy proposals before a UN commission, a United Nations commission. Now we need to ask, what was the great need for this encyclical? Why now? So I've gone through and listed a couple points, and you'll see the progression and the crescendo and the path that led to the encyclical being promulgated or coming out in June of 2015. Since his election in March of 2013, almost 4 years ago, it's hard to believe, Francis has shown concern for the environment following the trail and the footsteps of Pope Benedict XVI. Benedict, as I said, was the Green Pope. From the beginning of his Petrine ministry, Francis made it clear that his choice of his papal name was Francis of Assisi, patron saint of ecology, because of his great concern for the environment. I'll never forget the first audience of Francis. He was elected on Wednesday, and part of my responsibility 2 days later, working at the Vatican, was to gather together the journalists so their first meeting with the Pope. It was a magical moment, 6,000. There were 6,400 accredited journalists to the conclave and hundreds more non-accredited. They didn't fill out the forms. Most of them were English speaking, and that was part of my job, dealing with them. But that first audience in the hall, and of course one of Francis's things is he comes with a prepared text and you wait for that moment in the beginning, kind of looks at him, here, tells the secretary, put this on the website, now we'll talk. This is wonderful, all of us are clapping, and most of you say, oh, this is wonderful. It's dreadful when you're working at the Vatican, but, oh, the text is not there. This causes terrible anxiety and intestinal difficulties for some of the people working there. But Francis is notorious for giving this, he does this. So he puts down the text and he says, folks, I want to tell you why I chose the name Francis. Some of you got him a Jesuit, and therefore it's Francis Xavier, the great missionary going to the Far East. No. Or some of you thought it was Francis this. No. I'll tell you why. He said, as soon as I was elected, I'll never forget this, watching him. As soon as I was elected, and I realized that the votes had risen to 2/3, which means un papa eletto, a pope is elected, Cardinal Humes from Brazil, an elderly retired cardinal, who was sitting next to him, got up and went over to him. He says, Cardinal Humas, my friend, came over and he kissed me on the forehead. And he said, Jorge, remember the poor. Non dimenticare I poveri. Remember the poor. And Francis said, the idea flashed through my mind, Francis of Assisi. And I looked across the Sistine Chapel and I saw some of the cardinals from the countries at war, some of the patriarchs in the Middle East. And I realized Francis was a man of peace. And then I realized that Francis is the lover of the environment and the patron of ecology. And therefore, I'm named after Francis of Assisi. Francis of Assisi, that great saint. It's an important thing to remember right from the beginning. What I like so much about this pope is he's living out his name on a daily basis. Not all of us can say we do that. But it's this unpacking of this great gift that he announced there. On World Environment Day, June the 5th, 2013, just a couple months after, you begin to hear the echoes sounding, the music sounding, that was going to lead to Laudato Si. On that day, Francis stressed the need to cultivate and care for the environment. He said it's part of God's plan that man nurtures the world with responsibility, transforming it into a garden, a habitable place for everyone. He also said we're losing the attitude of wonder, contemplation, listening to creation. The implications of living in a horizontal manner is that we have moved away from God. We no longer need the beautiful signs of God. He issued to the church and the world a profound challenge to rethink the culture of waste and to contemplate seriously and act with conviction against the dynamics of an economy and finance that lack ethics. And this, of course, has sent the Bay Street people and Wall Street people and all kinds of others into orbit. And as soon as Francis says something, who is he to speak? How can he speak? He's not an economist. He's not this. He's not a scientist. I tell people he taught chemistry in high school, in a Jesuit high school. He knows about science. He also knows the people he can rely on for proper information. He knows about economy. He knows about money. He knows about that because he was on the receiving end of poverty in South America. Francis wrote, man is not in charge today. Money is in charge. Money rules. And if you follow anything of the daily homilies from the Santa Marta Chapel, this is a very recurring theme about money. That money eventually kills us. He's very strong, too, about money and priests. That money will do us all in. When we love money, when we don't love people and love God. As Benedict had often done, Francis links human ecology with environmental ecology. In fact, there's a stunning, magnificent document of Pope Benedict, very theological, part of the trilogy of his encyclicals, Caritas in Veritate. I think it came out in 2009. There's a wonderful chapter there where Benedict did something that nobody else was able to do at the time. Benedict brought together the whole, if you will, social justice arm of the church and all of those claiming to be on the side of life, the pro-life people, and said, they're not two separate groups. They must come together, because if we say we are pro-life, if we stand for life from the earliest moments to the final moments, from conception till natural death and everything in between, we must also be deeply concerned with the care of the earth and environment. And that's a major, major step that Pope Benedict did. Francis writes, I'd like to like us all to make a serious commitment to protect life and to protect creation. In 2014, in other words, a year later, in an address to the diplomatic corps accredited to the Holy See, it's like the talk that he gave this past Monday when he speaks to all of the ambassadors and kind of outlines the big picture themes. Where are we? What's happening in the world? And where is the church and all this? Well, in 2014, Francis noted the devastation caused by Typhoon Haiyan in the Philippines several months before. And he warned people against the greedy exploitation of environmental resources. He quoted the popular adage, and I'll quote it here, God always forgives. We sometimes forgive, but when nature is mistreated, when creation is mistreated, she never forgives. And this set a lot of people off. They said, what's he talking about here? Is this some kind of a, looking into the crystal ball or whatever? No, it's called wisdom. When we care for nature, nature cares for us. And here I'll just make a little promotion or publicity thing, which I'll talk about more, but I think it fits in here. While all of this was going on, while Benedict was writing Caritas in Veritate, in 2012, We got the idea at Salt and Light to make a major documentary on ecology and creation from the Catholic perspective, because up until this point, there had been nothing. And Hilary Weston and Galen Weston from the Weston Foundation gave us the money to do it. So we started filming. It took 4.5 years to complete. It's called Creation. It's a stunning documentary. In fact, right smack in the middle of the filming, we have a change in papacy. I remember telling Pedro and our production team, I said, okay, stop, we gotta see where we're going. We don't know what's gonna happen. Who's coming after Benedict or whatever? Then when Francis came, and I came back home from the conclave and everything, I said, this is full steam ahead. We got a pope who's big time into creation. And so we're six half-hour episodes. And the first three deal with the theology and the scripture and everything else. And the next three, because of Francis's arrival on the scene, deals with much of the theology, the spirituality that came with Francis. I mention it because one of my favorite segments of the whole thing, which really fulfills the idea, when we care for creation, creation cares for us. We were in the last stages of filming a year and a half ago, and we had gone to water purification plants and all kinds of places around the United States and Canada and the third world to show the devastating effects of a lack of care of creation and the places where creation is cared for. And I remember Pedro was in Florida, our team was in Florida filming, and they were in a water purification place. And he called me and he said, oh, we're near Clearwater, we're going to the aquarium. So I happened to say, get home, we need the thing done. I said, all right, go to the aquarium. I said, what's at the aquarium? He said, no, there's a story, we're gonna go to the aquarium, and we're gonna film something. Have any of you seen the movie, big movie at the theater, called Dolphin Tale? Dolphin Tale, part two is now being made in this movie. Dolphin Tale is the story of a huge dolphin that got in some accident in the water and the tail was cut off. And without the tail, the dolphin can't swim. The mammal can't swim. And so this Clearwater Aquarium in Florida has a specialized department, an emergency department, for fish and animals in trouble. Turtles and all kinds of other things. They send out ambulances and they pick these things up and they take care of them. So this dolphin on the other coast of Florida was wounded. And they go and pick up this and it caused this great stir. It was all, fortunately, people filmed it that later became the movie. And as part of it, the scientists and the caretakers and the curators and whatever developed a prosthesis for the dolphin that the dolphin was able to swim again. It was a real big thing. So I remember when they're talking to me on the phone, I'm trying to picture a prosthesis for a dolphin. How is this going to fit into all of this? Well, the segment on this in the movie is absolutely gorgeous. I've used it often because I'm on the cycle right now for preaching the retreats to the bishops of the United States on 7 or 8 of the retreats. And I show this when we talk about Laudato Si, and not one single time have people gone away without tears in their eyes. Because what happened is this aquarium has now become a site where all kinds of people, and children especially with prostheses, who've had terrible accidents and whatever, they go there and they put the kids in the water with these animals and they get to swim it. And they're beautiful stories. You see these kids that are terribly wounded with prostheses and one leg and whatever, and suddenly they're in the water with Dolphin Tail, with the fish, the big animal. And the little kids are saying, if they can do it, I can do it. And for me, this is the living proof that when we care for creation and we look after it, creation will then help to heal us. So buy the series. We brought copies of it. It's a gorgeous thing. This is a paid-for announcement I'm giving you. I'm telling you. And in the 6-part series, we did a huge study guide. It's not like this. It's much smaller. And the study guide is meant for groups, parish groups, families, children. It's a wonderful, wonderful 6-part documentary series. And when I told Pope Francis about it last year, he was absolutely thrilled. In fact, he gave me a couple copies of the encyclical and signed them and say, thanks for what you did with creation. That's the name of the series. So we brought that in the back. End of paid service announcement. Laudato Si is a good opportunity for us to distinguish between ecology as science and ecologism as an ideology. When anything becomes an ideology, it turns people off. It kind of becomes locked up. Ecologies that seemingly begin with the program of saving our environment quickly run their logic to the point where the environment takes absolute priority over human beings, and there's no more concern for human beings. Embrace the earth, kiss the planet, kiss the dirt, kiss the trees. Who cares about human life? When taken to the extreme, many make this erroneous claim that the human person is simply one of a very large number of species, all equally valuable and enjoying the same rights. That is exaggeration. That is ideology. That's not what Catholic ecology and the spirituality involving the environment is about. One ideology which is widespread in environmentalist circles is the myth, a big myth, about overpopulation. Those who exaggerate the effect of climate change are also the same ones who want population control and all which that entails. And you know what is entailed there. Care for the environment was a natural way of life in the medieval monasteries. We're not the ones who invented care for creation and the environment. It was the monasteries. And I love having made many retreats in some of the old European monasteries. If you go, I love going to the gift shops in the monasteries. And you see all the herbal things that they make and the plants. I remember making a long retreat once in a monastery, and I asked for tea. So the brother, the monk, was in Germany. He brought me this tray with all these branches and twigs and everything else. I said, no, I like tea. He says, that's it. So what do you mean that's it? He says, well, if you dip this one, this is miramilla or whatever it was called, this is good for stomach ailments. I said, do you wash this stuff? No, you put it in hot water. And this is good for this. This is good for your love life. I said, I don't need that one. But that bespeaks an old tradition of the monasteries who were very concerned about creation and the environment, herbal foods, all the things that are good for us. You see, Laudato Si, to recover the integrity of creation, we really need a whole renewed Christian perspective. We need new lenses. It's nothing new. It's going back to recapture what was there. For Benedict, human ecology was imperative, especially in Caritas in Veritate. What did Benedict speak about as he laid the groundwork for his successor? Adopting a lifestyle that respects our environment and supports the research and use of clean energies that preserve the patrimony of creation and that are safe for human beings should be given political and economic priority. This is not just privatized things. This has got to be elevated, escalated to political and economic priorities. In Caritas in Veritate, which you should really read together with Laudato Si, and in the subsequent writings and teaching and homilies and letters of Benedict, he called for the development of a human ecology, a very important word, grounded in the idea of creation, which is a beautiful gift of God. The human being will be capable of respecting other creatures only if the human person keeps the full meaning of life in his own heart. Otherwise, what happens is human beings come to despise themselves and their surroundings and to disrespect the environment and the creation in which we live. Benedict, therefore, towards the end of his pontificate, called for a change in mentality in order to quickly arrive at a global lifestyle that respects the covenant between humanity and nature. Another important thing that Benedict laid the groundwork for was the idea that technology dominates human beings and deprives us of our humanity. A perfect example of this is what communications has done to us. This past weekend, 4 days leading up to the weekend, I was speaking to all of the seminarians of the state of Florida, and from Puerto Rico, and from Cuba. It was a big retreat in Florida. Don't worry, the weather was lousy the whole time and I froze. I went down to get some wind and some rain because I had rain. I went down to get some sun because I had a cold and it was freezing. Anyway, but one of the things that was striking is I talked to them about the whole relationship of communications, telecommunications, social media, and its impact upon us. And I had them laughing in stitches a couple times. But it was one of those laughters saying, this guy's right. Just look at what social media has done to us in terms of our relationship to the greater picture, to the greater world. Has it really brought us closer together? In the building where I live, I tell people, every morning, we do body slamming in the elevator. You get in the elevator, go out of the elevator, and people walk right into you now. Because they come out, they're not looking at you, nobody looks at each other. You're looking down, and you have wires in your ears, and you walk into somebody. We're bombarded with all kinds of stuff coming into us. How much news do you need? I long for the day of turning on television where you watch one picture. Thank God it's salt and light. We don't have the ticker tape here, the ticker tape there, the thing at the bottom, the news coming there. You don't know what to look at. I just want to look at Peter Mansbridge. I want to watch that person. I don't want to see all this stuff. It's sensory overload. All of this is a way of, what does it do? Oh, I need to be informed. I tease our staff. We have a wonderful staff at Salt and Light. One of them is here with us. He doesn't do this, but others do. You walk around to their workplaces, and they're all working very hard. We no longer have one computer screen now. We have three or four. And on top of that, we have the iPad, and then the iPhone, and usually some wires in. And I tease them, because some of them, they have earphones. But not earphones, normal earphones. It looks like a helicopter pilot. Okay? So I walk around and say, good morning. Good morning! You know, say hello. Well, I'm connected. I've got to be connected. How many of you have got kids that come home for dinner? If I were a parent right now, I know what I would do. You come to the table, turn the thing off. I go to board meetings with our board members. These are big wigs, big people. And I say, please turn the machine off. Well, they put it on vibration. So you're sitting at the board meeting. This thing's moving all over the table. You know, it's kind of fidgeting. Or the new phenomenon that takes place, which is fascinating. I didn't believe my staff when they told me this, but 2 years ago, a year and a half ago, they said, Father, there's a new thing. Because I'm with young people, and so I'm the old one. And so they make me feel very old. They said, Father, there's a new phenomenon that somebody is able to text when they're talking to you. I said, it's impossible. I got enough trouble to pay attention to the person. No, 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 it happens. I said, yeah, right. So at the time, we were hiring. And so we had interviews going on. And I had, that morning, a young man and a young woman came in for their interviews. Mind you, they made the triage, and they come in for an interview. And this young man, very well dressed, is sitting in front of me. And all of a sudden, and I said, what are you doing? Oh, no, no. I said, you're here for a job interview. So I ended the job interview. I said, that's it. And he said, you're very rude. So he left. The girl comes in right after him. And not only that, she didn't turn the phone off. The phone rings. And then she's, you know, not rings, the message comes, ding! And I'm talking to her, and I said, wait a minute, you're here for a job interview. Out! Oh, that's very rude. I said, get out of here, I don't want that kind of person working with us. But this is very common. This is this whole thing of the ecology of time, the respect of persons. It's all related here. Is it truly bringing us closer together? No. I have very serious doubts. That being said, there's some wonderful things with social media. Can you imagine having run a World Youth Day without social media, without fax? We had faxes. The other day I realized that some of the people on my staff didn't know what a fax was. That tells you how old it is, how old it is. So what's a fax? What's that? You mean F-A-C-T-S? I said, no, F-A-X. What is that? I told them, well, it's this prehistoric thing from the Flintstones. But it's happening so fast. But part of the whole sensory overload, what is it doing to us? What is all of this stuff does to our sentiments, our feelings, our way of relating to one another? What's it doing to the environment? What's it doing to the ways we relate? Does it truly interconnect us, or does it separate us even more? Technology that dominates human beings deprives them of their humanity. The pride that it generates has created an impossible economism in our societies, as well as a hedonism that subjectively and selfishly regulates behavior. I remember being on the plane last year, and I brought my laptop with me because I try to do work, and I have a good computer, a good MacBook Pro, 2 years old, but it works. So I put it on. The guy sitting next to me said, oh, it's too bad. I said, what's too bad? He said, the thing is really slow. Throw it out and buy the newest one. I said, throw it out? I would never get rid of this. It's like my wife. I need this with me, okay? I said, what do you mean throw it out? He said, no, no, you need this much faster. It's got to be a nanosecond. It's got to be this right away. So we're caught up into this. They asked me, what generation? Once I got asked, my staff sometimes, I make a fool out of myself. What generation are you? I said, third generation, second generation Italian. Looked at me and said, what? I said, second generation Italian. My grandparents are from Italy. Oh, no, no, I meant the iPhone. 3G, 4G, are you 5S, 6S, 7S, and everything else? What do we do with all this stuff? In the building where I live, in the garbage room, in the recycling room, I've never seen this before. We just moved into a new building. And you go in the recycling room, it's like a research department of a laboratory. There must be 10 different boxes with equipment, iPhones, this is all stuff to dispose. And all it's very carefully organized. Every morning I stop in to throw something there, and the thing is full. It's full with all this stuff, the equipment, the plastic, whatever it is. What is it doing to the environment? In his 2010 World Peace Day message, Benedict, even back then, entitled the message, "If you want to cultivate peace, protect creation." So we see here the ground was being prepared for this monumental encyclical, Laudato Si. Integral human development, integral creation. If you want to cultivate peace, protect creation. Let's go back to Francis. Laudato Si must be read not only as a great gift or teaching of Catholic social teaching, but as a great instrument of the first evangelization and the new evangelization and a witness to ecumenism and interreligious dialogue. There's an internal mechanism in Laudato Si which has already accomplished some great things. People say, oh, we can't get the young people to show up for anything. They won't show up for the Bible study. They won't come for this. They won't come for that. Many priest friends of mine, many university chaplains have said, we have a spirituality group for ecology and the environment. The study document is Laudato Si. 50 people showed up. 60 people showed up. Friends in ecumenical settings have said, where people wouldn't come together to talk about theological issues or whatever, they're coming together to talk about our common home. And one of the first signs that we knew that Pope Francis struck gold with this, who was one of the first big interreligious groups that signed on? Councils of Imams, Muslims, that said this is a way to talk about our common home. My Jewish friends have referred to this because the document is so beautifully formed together, beginning with the spirituality and theology of Genesis, the whole biblical tradition that appeals to everybody. And if you read the document carefully, the first two pages or three pages are a dedication, a praise of the ecumenical patriarch Bartholomew, the ecumenical patriarch of the Orthodox churches, because they were ahead of us in the game, long ahead of us. And Francis has a very unique relationship with the ecumenical patriarch. In fact, the day it came out, June the 17th, 2 years ago, I was in Washington, and I had been scheduled, before we knew about the release date, to address this very big gathering of Orthodox and Catholic leaders. It was an Orthodox-Catholic dialogue. And none of them had seen the encyclical. I had received it a couple days early to prepare for it. So I got there, and you have Orthodox bishops and leaders and Catholic leaders. And I said, I want to start reading this. And this is what it reads right at the beginning. It's really, really gorgeous. In the words of the beautiful canticle, St. Francis of Assisi reminds us of our common home. This sister now cries out to us because of the harm we've inflicted on her. We have come to see ourselves as her lords and masters, entitled to plunder her at will. And then he praises, at the same time, Bartholomew, Patriarch Bartholomew, has drawn attention to the ethical and spiritual roots of environmental problems, which require that we look for solutions not only in technology, but in a change of humanity. Otherwise, we would be dealing merely with symptoms. He asks us to replace consumption with sacrifice, greed with generosity, wastefulness with a spirit of sharing, and asceticism that entails learning to give and not simply to give up. It is a way of loving, of moving gradually away from what I want to what God's world needs. The Pope praised Patriarch Bartholomew and the Orthodox churches for leading the way for us. This is really a very important statement to make in an encyclical of the Roman Pontiff. And it's right there in the beginning. Laudato Si lays the groundwork for a new humanism, for in the end, it is in the name and mission of Jesus of Nazareth that the Pope issues this call to conversion. It's an opportunity to go back into our Catholic tradition and to learn from the popes who have been speaking about this. Leo XIII, John Paul II, Benedict, Francis, Rerum Novarum, Centesimus Annus. All of these documents sounded the echo, sounded the overture. Laudato Si is important for those in business. Francis recognizes business as a noble profession. There are some who say he's condemning business, condemning capitalism, condemning this. No! What do we do with what we have? How do we help the poor? How do we take care of the earth? Our nature is created by God and surrounded by the gifts of creation. Our failures are that we overconsume and we do not share the gifts of creation. There's a line, we've tilled too much and kept too little, with dire consequences for the poor and the planet. And so it is urgent that we change our sense of progress, our management of the economy, and our style of life. We really are called to conversion. Now more than ever, the world needs leadership in all fields of this endeavor. Everyone has to play a role. Francis says this is not just for people in ecology or social justice or scientists or weathermen or stuff like that. He exhorts everyone in high positions, in low positions, people at home, people at work, people in factories, to take responsibility for this home that's been given to us. Why should we care for the environment? This is the last part, and I'll stop for some questions. This is the question that Francis asks us. This is the question that we of Salt and Light have grappled with in our documentary series. Many around the world have grappled with the urgent questions of the environment and ecology by focusing just on political and ideological solutions. We have to go deeper about ecology and the environment and consider it in terms of God's revelation in the beautiful story of creation from the book of Genesis. Look at the Bible as a whole. There's two poles in the Bible. In the beginning, it's in a beautiful garden that God gave us that we made a mess with. And in the end, the Bible ends in the beautiful book of Revelation, where we're back in the garden, and the tree of life is in the middle of that garden. And the leaves of that tree are used for the healing of the nations. It's a global biblical vision. It's our hope at Salt and Light when we produce the series, when we teach about Laudato Si, that this reflection will become a significant contribution to environmental education. It's so important in developing new awareness and solid Christian spirituality. This is a solid Christian spirituality. At the heart of Laudato Si is this question. What kind of world do we want to leave those coming after us? What about our children who are now growing up? Will they have a place they can call home? A place that's safe? A place that's beautiful? The last part is Francis is living our vocation to be protectors of God's handiwork is essential to a life of virtue and a life of gratitude, and a life of simplicity, and a life of hope, and a life of joy. At the conclusion of Laudato Si, Francis does something which had never been done before. He offers two profound and striking prayers. In the first prayer, we recognize God's presence in all creation and ask him to pour out upon us his love so we can rescue the abandoned and the forgotten. We ask for healing so we can protect the world and not prey upon it, P-R-E-Y. Francis says, teach us, we pray, to discover the worth of each thing, to be filled with awe and contemplation, to recognize that we are profoundly united with every creature. And the prayer concludes, encourage us, we pray, in our struggle for justice, love, and peace. If you notice, there's no mention there of Jesus. There's a prayer to the Creator. It's a prayer that everyone can say who does not know Jesus. But in our final prayer, it's beautiful. We acknowledge not only the Creator, but the Son of God who became part of this earth. We profess that in his risen glory, he is alive in every creature. And we recognize the Holy Spirit guiding the world towards the Father's love and accompanying creation as it groans and travails. What a very interesting, beautiful touch. An interfaith touch and a Christian touch with Jesus the Son who is one of this earth. And I conclude with his words. We ask the Triune Lord to teach us to contemplate you in the beauty of the universe and to show us our place in this world as instruments and channels of your love for all creatures of the earth. You can almost hear Francis of Assisi singing those words. I'll pause there. We'll come back for some questions and we can argue this.
We have and everyone here, I want to say how honored we are that you came to visit us. And I want to say that your insights and the beautiful quotes that you gave us from the encyclical has given us a great deal of thought, of things to think about. There's not one crisis, I mean, there's not two crises of the ecology and humanity, there's just one. And everything is integrated, and we have to think about that. We have to think in our daily lives what we can do to simplify our lives and to really live the message of the encyclical. So on behalf of the people here, I'd like to present this with you, and thank you again.
Thank you.